Welcome to Someone Talked, the official podcast of the National D-Day Memorial, where leading experts spill all the secrets of the Second World War, with your host, Dr. John C. McManus.
Greetings. Welcome to Someone Talked. I'm your host, Dr. John C. McManus from Missouri S&T, and alongside are my wonderful partners in crime, as always, from the National D-Day Memorial Foundation, April Cheek Messier, Angela Lynch, and John Long. How are you all today? Great to see you.
Great to see you. We're excited to talk 80th anniversary.
That's right. We're recovering from
it. I know. Everybody's still recovering. I'm sure you are too, John, from your world travels. So.
Yeah, it was an intense time, wasn't it?
It was. But, so gratifying. I think, we're all going to have different perspectives, I guess, because, we were here, obviously, with our events at the memorial. But you were there in Normandy. And I think we haven't talked to you since your trip. We want to know how was Normandy? How was everything?
Well, Normandy was, wall to wall people, as you might expect, as it always is. So I was with the National World War II Museum folks who put together this amazing D-Day 80th cruise. And so the cruise actually had a pre-tour. We worked our way down the coast aboard this amazing ship called the Seabourn Ovation, this beautiful luxury ship. And I know it's tough duty, but someone has to do it, I guess. That's the sacrifice I make for my
country.
Yes, we
feel for you, though. Yes.
We
get a medal right out to you.
I mean, I don't want to use the word hero. We had about 600 guests aboard the ship.
Oh, wow.
Amazing group. So I was one of four featured historians. It was me, Don Miller, Alex Ritchie, and Keith Lowe. Just a really good crew. Great. And then they also had Nick Mueller from the World War II Museum, who, it occurred to me during this tour in the cruise, the only reason any of us were even there is because of Nick. Nick, in tandem with Stephen Ambrose, founded the World War II Museum. Mm-hmm. It's all really, in many respects, due to him. So he gave a presentation on Point de Hoc, and then they had several of the museum's historians from the Jack Craig Institute for the Study of War and Democracy. That included Mark Calhoun and John Curatola and Mike Bell. So we had a nice mix of folks, and we started in Hamburg and sort of looked at the got a good sense of the bombing and the terrible firebombing raid. Keith Lowe has actually written a book about it, so he gave a fascinating presentation. We visited Neuengamme. I don't know if any of y'all have ever been there. That's a really not very well-known concentration camp, but a pretty major one in Northwest Germany, and then a major bunker, like a submarine bunker that's in the general area that was built by slave labor coming from that camp and other labor camps. So the whole thing started there, and then we kind of worked our way down the coast. There was a day when we were at Amsterdam, and I personally went to Arnhem that day. So you could go on all these various excursions because there were so many people and so many different possibilities. So I only know it sort of through my lens of where I actually went. But there were, a number of highlights, but one of which was that when we docked in England for a couple of days at Great Yarmouth, and we spent a couple of days at the 8th Air Force Airfield, which of course is a spinoff from Don's work, Masters of the Air, obviously. It's just been an amazing thing this year. And we went to Thorpe Abbotts, where the 100 Bomb Group is based. That's, the unit portrayed in Masters of the Air. And it was very special for me because it had been a long time since I'd been to East Anglia to check out the airfields. I did that, really, I hate to say this, dating myself, almost a quarter century ago in doing research for a book called Deadly Sky, The American Combat Air War, World War II. So, I'd been to Thorpe Abbotts at that time, but to see how it had changed and the museum they have there. There's another incredible museum at Horum, where the 95th Bomb Group was based. And I'm just so impressed with the dedication of many local folks to make these places special, to keep it alive, to welcome visitors. They know their stuff. In many cases, they put on, there was a big band. These are people who obviously are good musicians, and then they're in period dress, and and know it backwards and forwards. So it was really a fun event from a kind of almost a diplomatic standpoint of Anglo-American relations on some levels, mm-hmm. too. It was very special. So the core of our tour, of course, was going to Normandy, and we get there roughly about like June 3rd and 4th in that window. So I went to on June 4th to some of the British airborne areas, and including Pegasus Bridge, where I've been many times, but I had a new experience there this time. I don't know if this has ever happened to you all, but the bridge itself raised up like an actual drawbridge. And I have never had that experience there. It had been three times in the space of 2 hours when I was there. And that only made the traffic that much crazier. It was such a madhouse. And the funny thing is that my buddy James Holland and I were trying to hook up. As you know, he and I host a podcast too. And we wanted to do an on-site episode. And he was coming from Con. I was coming from, you know, the ship and, you know, on our coach and all this stuff. And just the whole like logistics of being able to eventually hook up. It probably took us 45 minutes to work that out, and how frenetic it all was. And I just thought to myself, gosh, you know, this is with modern communications and a supposed modern era. And it was that tough for Jim and me to actually
coordinate and be
imagine in World War II, if you had, you know, some sort of situation where you're trying to link up with another unit or whatever, how crazy that would have been. And so Pegasus Bridge area was just a madhouse. And the beautiful museum there was, I'm not exaggerating, you could stand in the museum and you could probably not turn left or right without bumping into another person. That to me is no fun. So I steered clear of that. Mm-hmm. It was just walking around the area trying to link up with Jim mostly. But the highlight for me, there were several highlights beyond that for me. On June 5th, I and also a couple of the French battlefield historians led an Omaha Beach hike. And we started at WN62, walked down on the beach past 61, and then climbed up WN60. So that's like the big red one portion of the beach. Mm-hmm. It was a very special experience, I think, for the guests to get that kind of immersion tour and to really, you know, hopefully bring that to life. Then we concluded at Colville, which you all know very well, of course. And then the next day, June 6th, we were there for the Normandy American Cemetery ceremonies with Presidents Biden and Macron. We had about 130 veterans, I was told there. I just couldn't believe that. Yeah. And so, you know, the ceremony started late, about 45 minutes late, because Macron had to helicopter in from another ceremony. And in the meantime, they were just wheeling in veteran after veteran after veteran, including some from our tour. We had, I think, 9 total on our cruise. Sadly, one of them died during the cruise, unfortunately.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, that was really, really kind of really a bummer. But the others pressed on. You know, they were just amazing guys. So they were part of this, too. We had to get up about 4:30 that morning and, you know, in order to have any hope of getting to the ceremonies around midday. We had to go through a security check at St. Lo, and then you know, work our way in with the other buses to the cemetery. And oh my gosh, it was just crazy situation. But we got there, and I think it was a very special ceremony. But then, you know, you're waiting for hours and hours on the way out because of the security and the traffic and whatever else. But this was, you know, another thing about that's great about the World War II Museum. They just do everything right. Sarah Kirksey, Darcy Williams, and all the other folks they work with just set everything up the right way and do it the right way. And they had us out of there within about 2.5 hours. Whereas some of my other friends who were part of other tours, they told me they were still there at night. My goodness.
So, do you get the sense, John, that it's, I mean, more because you've been to several of the larger commemorations. Was this even more well attended than previous ones, or what's your sense?
It seemed like it to me. Now, I don't know the actual numbers. Mm-hmm. I know the 75th was pretty heavy.
Yeah,
pretty similar in
size
in terms of the experience on June 6th at the cemetery and all that. But yeah, I mean, anywhere you were traveling, anywhere near the coast for those few days, you could expect a lot of traffic. And and not always that maybe we experienced, but we heard the horror stories. You know, so for instance, like June 7th, I think President Biden went to Point de Hoc that day, I believe. And I was just not there that day, but I heard from people who were on excursions, people on our cruise who were on excursions that were in anywhere near the area, just how crazy it was. I mean, the traffic and the security and how many hours that ate up. So I think that to me was pretty similar to what I've experienced on marker anniversaries before. And of course, the same kind of festive scenes of any kind of allied military vehicle you could imagine, including tanks, by the way, and reenactors. Some of them very good and very much attention to detail and age appropriate. Others maybe not so much. I saw this one dude, you know, he's got to be in his 70s and he's got a full beard and there's a really nice paunch working and he's wearing an airborne uniform. I'm just like,
he's very dedicated. He just can't give it up. Okay.
he's carried like a glass of beer and I'm like, no, I appreciate the sentiment, but I don't know that you've really nailed it.
There's a fine line between reenactment and cosplay.
Where are we here?
I know. I mean, I realized a long time ago that I aged out of the whole reenactment.
Right.
And, you know, and I think this gentleman might have been wise to realize maybe the same thing, but I don't know that he was looking at it the same way I did. But there's certainly some of that. So there's a lot of schlock, of course, you know, selling this, that, and the other thing, D-Day 80th, you know, souvenir stuff, as you can imagine. A lot of bars doing a lot of business, and that's great, right? I mean, that's partially why we fight, I suppose, but it also adds to sometimes there can be a carnival-like aspect to it.
Did anything feel particularly different for the 80th anniversary as you experienced it?
Well, the unfortunate thing is the age of the veterans was even more pronounced,
right.
That was a little different to me in the sense that pretty much every guy was in a wheelchair, and that always been true in the past, and it was a little harder to communicate. It's just that part of it is I almost try not to think about it because it's very sad to me, and I don't have to tell you this. I mean, you know better than I think. You know, as time goes on, these guys are gone or they've aged or whatever. I just couldn't help thinking about a lot of the other guys I knew from past anniversary events or just people I knew or whatever, and wishing that they could have been part of it. You know, you just don't know what you have at the time, I guess, how lucky you are to know some of these guys and to be in their orbit. It occurred to me, it was a little bit wistful, in that sense, but also pretty cool that to still have any veterans there.
Yeah. Right, right. I think we felt much the same way. It's you're saddened on the one hand that you think about all those who've come before and who've been part of many of our events over the years. In fact, our program, we actually, in designing the program, pulled a lot of histories from those veterans who have participated in previous events at the memorial, or just been involved with the memorial through as volunteers, you know, D-Day veterans who were volunteers at one point, or, you know, just helped in the starting of the memorial. I mean, the history going back to all of those who really wanted to make sure that these legacies, not their legacy, but the legacy of all of their comrades were properly preserved. So, you know, we reflected on that a lot this time, and our theme was Every Story Lives On. So we really wanted to focus on those individual stories and telling those. And of course, we always, with the big anniversaries, like to frame our commemorations with just the stories. You know, we have a lot of dignitaries, we have a lot of people who come, but we don't do introductions. We don't, you know, the focus of the stories of those who served and what they did and what they achieved, and had a lot of people comment on that, just a lot of appreciation for that focus of, you know, of these individual stories. So I thought that was a big success for us to be able to highlight. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. That's what brings it to life.
Yes.
I mean, yeah. Absolutely. And you know, a lot of times it continues with family members. We had so many on, mm-hmm. on the cruise, mm-hmm. Children, grandchildren, nieces, nephews, cousins, you know, whatever. That's where it is nowadays in many respects. That's where you can kind of get the personal side of this whole thing. And that's what's very moving, too. I just think that part of it is always going to be there for us, at least. And I really enjoyed that. You know, it probably one of the most special experiences I had on this particular tour was actually after D-Day. We went to San Lo one day and did a deep dive tour of the battlefield. Again, a really good mix of people, because it was me, Mark Calhoun, who's done a terrific biography of Leslie McNair, and then the French battlefield historians who live there and know this. And so everybody could contribute their perspective to some extent. We went to Le Carrefour, which is where you had a really tragic small unit engagement a few days after D-Day between one of the battalions from the 29th Division and a retreating German unit that runs into them, kind of gets the drop on them, kills the battalion commander. The mayor of the town spoke to us. We there's some really interesting memorial markers there. We could visit the sites, and all the sort of Hill 192, which I'm sure you guys have been to that, where the 2nd Infantry Division fought so hard. And we had a clear day, so we could see all the way to the beaches. And that showed you immediately the value of Hill 192. And we happened to just bump into a French reenacting group, a good one, that portrayed a unit from the 2nd Infantry Division. And so here again was an interesting thing for the guests. You know, just everyday Americans, and here they get to meet everyday French people who are really into the same thing. And so the lieutenant of this unit spoke to us and gave us an overview of what happened with the unit he portrayed. You know, we had that experience, and then we went, you know, in to look at Major Howie's route. Of course, the major of St. Lo, Thomas Howie, battalion commander, was killed there and is memorialized to this day. And then we think we found the spot where General McNair was killed in the friendly fire bombings in Operation Cobra. So I had never had that experience before. And what's one of the things I love about going back to these places when there's something new, you know, something I haven't experienced before. So I think that was a very special day for the guests. And we were away from the craziness of the traffic and all that kind of stuff, too. So that was one of the funnest parts, I'd say.
I find it really interesting. You mentioned discovering things that are new, because everyone on this trip is probably looking at you and the other historians and asking lots of questions, and you're the expert, and here you are kind of learning and discovering and continuing that education. So that's really incredible, I think.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Definitely. Absolutely. And that's the fun of it. And sometimes their questions teach me things, you know, or they know things I don't.
Right.
Perspectives on their family or, you know, whatever it would be. Yeah, so it's fun because it's a learning environment for everybody. And these are, as I've often said, like the guests who come on these tours, it's as if you add, you know, 40 or 45 years to the age of my best students, a little bit more maturity, a little bit of money too, probably. And there they are. I mean, so they're just as into it and maybe even more so. And so it's so much fun to meet and hang around with people like that, who are so into it. Right. So, yeah, it was a really good tour. It was a really good tour, I think, in part because of the outstanding nature of the World War II Museum staff. But I think we got some breaks with the weather and the logistics and all that good stuff, too, which, as you know, you have to have. Right? Yeah,
weather is always a thing. Why is that?
Yeah. We definitely had our eyes on that.
We were hoping for, you know, Captain Stagg to show up so that we could really help us through.
We needed Captain Stagg. And so April, it was funny. We would joke about this last spring. I often joked with you that you were basically like Eisenhower, you know, in preparing for your staff for the 80th anniversary. You were sort of the Eisenhower of the D-Day Memorial. And I know how hard you and everybody else worked for weeks and months to prepare for this. So if you could walk us through what the 80th anniversary was like at the D-Day Memorial, what all you did and what you saw and what your experience was like. What also, too, I wanted to address with you, what worked out and what didn't in your, you know, in your view?
Well, like you said, it's an amazing team, and everybody had, you know, everybody wears many, many hats around here. We're a tiny staff, so everybody does everything. And, you know, this has been a year and a half in the making. The 80th anniversary was a lot of planning and preparation, just like you said, just like D-Day. And, you know, just can't, you know, Angela and John, y'all jump in too, because we, you know, we wanted to do some different things. We wanted people to experience the memorial in some different ways, and you know, outside of just the one day commemoration. So obviously that was incredible. We wanted to bring the veterans in the day before the commemoration and honor them. We did that at a local at the airport, and at a hangar, thanks to Mr. Don Banker. We appreciate him very much for letting us use the hangar. And we did a wonderful luncheon, welcomed the veterans there. We had some of the planes that were going to be doing our flyovers the next day were all there, so they could walk around and see them. And the veterans that we had were just amazing. I mean, they had so much. I mean, it was incredible to me, the energy level, and that they really fed off of everybody else's energy too. And of course, we fed off of their excitement, and just to how special that was. I think, you know, that's really what it was all about. It's making sure that they had an amazing week. And a lot, most of those veterans that were with us, they attended just about everything we did. And so it was just terrific. We rolled out the red carpet for them. We highlighted their stories. The commemoration was amazing. We really wanted to, again, focus on the stories themselves. We had almost 5,000 people in person, but we had something like 33,000, I think, watching,
and growing. People and are growing. Still watching it.
That's right. Yeah. People were continuing to watch. We had 33,000 watching our live stream. Plus, we had C-SPAN was there live. So we know a lot more people watched it. We had watch parties all across the country with people tuning in. And again, we wanted people to hear these stories, and that's what we focused on. So at the end, you know, we were a little concerned as the skies start to darken a little bit. We had a 2-hour ceremony. It was amazing. And then it starts to get a little dark. We wanted to make sure we recognized every single veteran that was there, all of our World War II veterans. And so we were able to do that. And then our chaplain from the UK got up and did the benediction, and then the skies opened up right after that. So in some ways it was just, in a weird way, it was beautiful. It was like, and nobody, I mean, you know, some people got on buses and left, but a funny thing, as hard as it was pouring for a little while, a lot of people just stayed. They just wanted the opportunity to see the veterans. They didn't want to leave. I mean, it was, most people stuck around for the better part of the day, and we had plenty to see with the living history, and we had our Higgins boat on site. We can tell you more about that in a little bit. We had, you know, just, oh gosh, just the Faces of the Fallen exhibit and the Portraits of Hero exhibit, yeah. Just lots to do. Exceptional authors, of course, Joe Bukowski, our friend, being one of them. So yeah, I mean, and really highlighting, for us, it was important to, you know, have that international presence, even though we're, you know, in Bedford, Virginia, this is our nation's monument to D-Day. And it's an international monument. We really wanted to press the point that D-Day was international in scope. It wasn't just the Americans. And so we had a huge contingent from NATO involved in our ceremony, who were involved in everything from reading our different passages, whether it was someone from, you know, we had embassies involved, we had NATO involved. I think that was really important to us, is to make sure that people understood. I mean, you know, if you look at NATO, I mean, a legacy of D-Day certainly is NATO. I mean, how do we, you know, make sure that what was achieved all those years ago remains preserved? How do we continue to protect that? It's our alliances, and those alliances remain critically important today. And so having their presence was spectacular, and they helped escort our veterans at the end in our procession. And it was just really touching, and of course meant a great deal to them as well. So huge presence. I know I'm leaving things out, so you guys jump in. What am I leaving?
Well, that's one of the many great things about the memorial. There's a dozen flags as you walk in there of the Allied nations that participated in D-Day, many of which, of course, are, I think all of which are in NATO and become, I've argued many times, that the seeds of NATO are sown on D-Day. And certainly our involvement and all that. So it's, I mean, I love the international character of all this. Mm-hmm. How did you and the staff coordinate that? You're working with people from a lot of different countries, and it couldn't have been easy. Everybody has maybe their own agenda or their own plan or whatever it is.
Especially when the packets get lost in the mail.
Yes, we had that happen. Yep. I think because we had so many people who wanted to be a part of it, we really, honestly, it was a lot of work, a lot of logistics to organize it. But people reached out to us, too. I mean, people wanted to be with us and wanted to take part in this special event. And so it was amazing to me how many people, you know, even before I was sending letters to the embassies, for example, we had people reaching out to us from the embassies or from NATO saying, we want to be there. And we were like, we want you to be here. And so let's coordinate who can come and be a part of it. And you kind of go from there. So I think when you have that kind of enthusiasm and that excitement, it makes it much easier. There's a lot of different pieces that you have to work through. Everything from logistics of, you know, adding the names to the wall. And I know our next episode, we'll talk about our necrology wall, but making sure that, you know, for the past year and a half, John's been working on making sure we've got the names verified that we want to add to the wall. And then, of course, there's logistics of making sure you can get those added to the wall and how you do that, because, you know, it takes time to get bronze plaques made. All those little logistics, of course, takes time. But you just have to plan way ahead, and cross your fingers and do a lot of praying. Yeah. I mean, isn't that what Eisenhower had to do? It's a lot of hope and a prayer. I crafted my own failure message in case it all went south, John.
You just found it in your pocket today.
It was in my pocket. Yep.
Where's April?
April's gone. I don't know. But she left this note. But
was there a Lee Mallory who said, you got to call off the...
Yes. I think you do prepare, though. In all seriousness, I think we were prepared for different scenarios. So we did plan for if it starts to downpour, we made sure all the buses were staged right around our circle at the memorial. So if it started downpouring, we had ponchos. There were ponchos. Our Liberty University was one of our sponsors. They were wonderful about making sure that we used their buses and their drivers, and they had made sure there were ponchos on every bus. So people had ponchos, and they did need them right at the end after it was all said and done. But nobody complained. There were no complaints. People really, they were just happy to be there. So, you know, you plan, and I think people can tell when something's, like you said, when something's very well organized, they don't tend to, I mean, you're always going to have some complaints about something, but for the most part, people were just happy to be there. I think they understood, you know, the significance of why and really had very little, there's nothing negative to really say. I mean, you wanted to meet veterans, you wanted to give your thanks. And so they did.
The reality of our site is we can have a lot of people mm-hmm. on site, but we just don't have room to park a lot of cars.
It takes a long time to get people up right. there.
So we have to use the shuttle buses and there's always some grumbling about that. Why can't I park right there? And the answer is because, you can park right there, but 10,000 other people want that parking space too.
And honestly, I think the thing we focused on, mostly as we should have is the veterans, just to make sure they were comfortable, that we had the National Guard provided a air conditioned, army tent so we could keep them cool. And then bring them out for the ceremony. We made sure that they were fed, that they had escorts, that they had everything they needed. And I think, that was paramount on everybody's mind, and then, everything else could fall into place, but we wanted to make sure we took care of our veterans first and foremost. So,
We had one family, especially joined us for the ceremony, lay a wreath, during the wreath laying. And that was the family of Waverly Woodson, mm-hmm. whom we've talked about on this podcast before. He was the medic from the 320th Barrage Balloon Battalion, the only African-American, unit to land on D-Day. And, for years, there has been an effort to, recognize Waverly Woodson's service. He received, I think it was a Bronze Star for what he did on D-Day, but as reports of what he accomplished and the lives that he saved kind of filtered out through the public with Linda Hervieu's book, Forgotten. It became clear that he deserved more recognition than he had gotten. And so just before D-Day this year, Waverly Woodson's Bronze Star was elevated to the Distinguished Service Cross, which is second only to the Medal of Honor. And I thought that was a great resolution just before, and to have some of his family with us to honor not just Waverly Woodson, but all of the 320th.
The Dabney family was here. Dabney was in the 320th, and it was just, that was beautiful. I loved seeing that. That was great.
And Woodson, I mean, what he did on D-Day is incredible. I mean, he's a medic, and he is treating dozens, maybe even hundreds of patients. He does an amputation on his own right there.
And he's wounded himself.
Even though he'd been wounded.
He's wounded himself.
Right.
Yeah. And who knows how many lives he saved.
And worked for like 36 hours or something before he finally got help of his own. I mean, just an incredible story.
Really is. Yeah. So did his family have a good sense of that, of what he had done and you know, what all this meant?
I think so.
I do. Yeah. I think they've been lobbying for a long time for his recognition. Good. So I think they were very, very well aware. And I have to say, the other thing I'm really proud of, and I definitely want John and Angela to talk about this, because they were talk about my partners in crime here. We've got we embarked on something a year and a half ago, too, with some colleagues at Virginia Tech, and decided to do a projection map story, basically, that would be projected on the memorial itself. And we had no idea how that was going to work. But we started meeting with them. And this team, which is the Virginia Tech Institute for Creativity, Arts, and Technology, were absolutely incredible. And we spent a year and a half putting together this, you know, they worked on a storyboard. We, you know, because part of this, and I know, John, you feel like this, part of it is we really wanted to appeal to younger people too. How do we start telling the story to a younger generation to, you know, captivate them on why this is important, why you need to know this history? And we just felt like this would be a unique way to do it. And I don't know, you guys speak to that. I think it turned out really, really exceptionally well.
we used ICAT really came up with the script, but they employed a poem called When We Went In, or it's called Omaha Beach, but mm-hmm. Starts out by When We Went In, and that was the title of our production that told the story of Omaha Beach from an eyewitness, Peter Thomas, who became very well known later as a voice actor and a voiceover announcer. And using that and other first-person accounts of D-Day with this incredible projection, it was just, you know, it's hard to describe on a audio podcast. Mm-hmm. You had to be there.
You can't describe it. It's
to
hard.
See if you can imagine, John, you know, our arch with screens around it and projecting like, you know, I want to say a drive-in movie theater, but it's 10 times better than that.
Right.
And the sound quality, it was really an experience that people, I think a lot of people who came to the Friday night showing immediately went home and bought tickets to Saturday night to see it again. And say it was just incredible.
Well, something happened that I hadn't seen before in a long time anyway, was that after the showing and we sold out the first night. So we had 1500 people, but after the showing there was silence. Like people just kind of got up and they were so moved and there was almost speechless. Like, how do you, you know, I don't know how to describe it, but it was a very, some people were crying. Some people were just in awe. You know, it really struck you kind of the enormity of D-Day and the sacrifice. And I think people were really just absorbing it at the end. And so I was really gratified by that.
I was kind of struck, both nights, but particularly Saturday night, by the amount of families I saw there with even younger children. My daughter's 13. She came with us on Saturday night and really enjoyed it. But even just, you know, little kids on up, we were very careful in telling the story, not to be gratuitous, overly graphic. I mean, of course, the subject matter, you've got to approach it. And, you know, tell it accurately, but making it something that families could enjoy, that veterans could come and enjoy and not have any sort of negative reaction to. So we were very, very cautious in that regard. But it was really interesting to me, because even on event days, we do see, you know, young people there with their families, but something that they can actually sit and watch together that has a much different feel than a ceremony, because let's face it, kids get bored. But they didn't get bored with this. It was, you know, all eyes on the screen the whole time.
I had little kids come up to me and said, "You need to do that again."
Yeah. Yeah. Well, to that point, is it possible?
Yes, I think so. I mean, it's costly, but obviously from our ticket sales, it showed that we can recoup that cost. And, you know, it's not something you could, you know, you could do too frequently.
Can do every week.
But it's definitely something we want to do again. So I know people have asked us that, because a lot of people have said, "Oh, you're going to sell videos and things like that." And you just can't capture it the same way. You really have to be there to see it, to experience it. Because between with the sound and all the elements there, you really have to, the video doesn't do it justice.
No.
So we really want to do it again. So what we tell people is that, yes, we are going to do it again. We're not sure when yet, but it certainly will happen again. And obviously it was a big success, so we, you know, I think we'll just have to kind of plan. We're taking a little bit of a breather right now, and then we'll figure that out.
Yeah, we do have plans to you know, regroup with the folks at Virginia Tech. That's and right. Say, okay, what are the next steps, and to kind of, you know, because once it's made, we have it, we own it,
right.
it's ours to show as we please. But the setup for it is quite something, because obviously the main point is the arch, the Overlord Arch, but we had a screen in the middle of the arch, we had two screens to either side of it, the bunkers are part of the display area as well, and just the, you know, the scaffolding and putting the screens up and the work that goes.
Everything had to be designed specifically for the show.
Yeah, so even down crazy. To the type of material they're using for the screens.
Yeah,
it's precise.
Everything's very precisely done. But I can't say enough about Angela and John, who were such a huge part of this process with their different, you know, and like we said, with these team effort, everybody comes with different perspectives, and, you know, Angela's background and everything in media, and she really had a neat perspective on how it should move, you know, how the storyline should kind of go, and John with all the different oral histories and kind of pulling, because we wanted to make sure we covered as many stories we could to tell the diverse story of D-Day. So whether it was Evelyn Kowalczyk, who's a nurse, flight nurse on D-Day, you know, for example, just this diversity, the 320th, but the home front story.
Preparation and training
and all of that. We wanted to encapsulate all that, but that can be difficult in 20 minutes. So, it was, there was a lot of challenges.
Well, I remember one of the earlier conversations, I think John Long said, "Well, how do we tell the whole story in this amount of time?" I said, "You don't.
That's right.
You can't. I mean, you do and you don't." And it kind of reminds me of back when I was doing television news, and you have a minute 15 to tell your story. And it's good gravy. That's not, hardly any time at all. But you make it work. And to the credit of the ICAT team at Virginia Tech, they understand how to put together a storyboard that moves. And when we were kind of looking at it, the initial script, and it's like, well, what about this? I'm like, let's wait until they get it together with the sound, with some of the video elements, the visuals there, because reading it on a script is very different than seeing how it plays out. And they'll know how to adjust down and, you know, cut things and move things around. And, you know, once we got that storyboard, it was pretty smooth, from there on out. It's like, okay, this is moving. Well. Yeah.
And I think in the end, for someone who really knows the story of D-Day well, like our tour guides, our volunteers at the site, this was a great experience. For someone who maybe was not so familiar, like the kids in the audience, I think it awakened a desire to learn more. So it was extremely effective. And Yeah, it was fun to not just watch it, but to kind of watch the audience watching.
Right. Yes, it was.
And it had a lot of different voices. Yes. You know, we were very interested in having different perspectives. And, you know, you were talking about the oral histories and the letters home, and which kind of created the storyboard. And then having Peter Thomas's narration throughout to set up the different segments. So kind of hit the high points in a lot of ways, but, you know, hearing female voices and different things, I think was really important.
British and French accents.
Yeah. That was really neat to show that it was kind of everyone.
Yeah, absolutely. And we're really thrilled. Oh, sorry. Go ahead, John.
Well, it strikes me, you know, sort of building on the point that I made earlier about, you know, the D-Day 80th cruise, and of course, all these events that you've just had on site at the memorial, it strikes me that this is where you see the talent pay off, having good people who know what they're doing. And I don't know that that's all that different than Schaaf and Eisenhower back then. You know, you've got a kind of an all-star team.
And well, I'd say less at stake. if we had really messed it up,
I mean, only
the world would continue.
That's true.
But would it? As a leader, you have to let it fly. You know, you got to let people do their thing, and this is where you find out what they do, what they can make happen. And I mean, obviously, that worked really well.
Yeah,
you know, at the memorial for the 80th, it definitely did during our cruise. There's a leap of faith there in a way that I think is very similar to without the same kind of stakes, obviously, to Eisenhower saying, well, now it's in the hands of all these young people to go make this happen for us. You know, it's I don't know. It's just it's very moving. And I love the idea of having this show again somehow. That's going to attract a lot of people, young people, to the memorial and get people psyched up.
Well, and I do think that's the turning point we're in now, is that, you know, for so many years, the commemorations, it was paying tribute to our veterans, and it always will be, but our veterans aren't going to be with us much longer, as we saw with this anniversary, how few are left. So it's really now about making sure and reassuring our veterans that we are telling your story to young people, that there's going to be a whole new generation that's going to learn these stories, and they're going to carry it with them, and they're going to tell their kids, that we keep that going. And I think, you've got to kind of meet that generation where they are. And that's a lot of technology right now.
For sure. Exactly.
And nothing wrong with that.
No. And so, that's kind of what we look at. And we've done a lot of experimentation with our app, and with creating some augmented reality experiences and things like that now. And I think that's, you know, that's what we have to continue to do. And we will. Let me
mention, John, because this will interest you, and I didn't realize it till you know, staff member gave us some numbers the other day. But in terms of student visitation, school groups, both visiting the site and watching online, this was our second busiest year since the founding of the National D-Day Memorial. We had, counting the virtual visits, something like 9,000 kids go through our programming. And so, you know, we had a great event in June, but we want to inspire this next generation of World War II aficionados who can appreciate what happened. And so I was very happy that we've had so many kids come through.
Great. Amazing. I mean, let's just say you fire up and get excited, just 10 to 20% of them. And everything that's going to mean throughout their lives, who knows? Maybe some of them are going to do work of their own on D-Day. Maybe they'll end up there at the memorial. Maybe they'll be supporters. Who knows where this leads? That's just such a wonderful investment in the next generation.
Yeah.
And I think it's terrifically exciting to see that happen. I'm really glad to hear that.
Let me also mention, because I know we're running short on time, but we have an LCVP on site, and that came for the 80th commemoration. I mean, maybe I geek out too much over it, but there's a tangible reminder. It's not a D-Day veteran. It was manufactured in August of 44, and we don't know the full history of what it did during the war, but it is in such good you know, historically accurate condition, and to be able to show that to people. Even though right now, this minute, it's under a canopy or under a tarp, you know, for weather protection until we can build a roof over it. People have just flocked to see that. Every time I look over there, yeah, when we're open, I see people standing there taking pictures, you know, pointing out little details. So I invite everyone listening, if you haven't been to the National D-Day Memorial this summer or this fall or, you know, into next year, come see our Higgins Bay. Because you really can't see them up close like this very many other places in the world.
Now, according to most articles, there's only 10 documented.
Yeah. Made by Higgins.
Yes. Left. Yeah. So, and this one actually still has the Higgins plate on it. So this one we know came from the Higgins factory directly. So it's pretty amazing. An amazing artifact.
That really is.
So we're working on some preservation efforts for that to make sure it stays at the memorial and that we keep it for, again, a whole new generation to see firsthand what that was like. So, yeah.
And I'd be remiss if I didn't say go to our webpage. If you're interested in supporting this project, we are certainly taking donations.
That's right.
Everyone is free to donate. Absolutely.
Give early and often.
And it's for a good cause. As you said. Now, I mean, what is a more appropriate place for it than there? I mean, I love that Higgins boat is there.
Yeah.
And just to get to touch it and get a sense of the dimensions and all that, I think, again, you know, brings history to life like few other things can.
Yeah.
Our kids' camp just a few weeks ago, we allowed the students to climb up on and get their picture taken on an actual Higgins boat. And I told them, where else are you ever going to be able to go to a camp and stand on a Higgins boat and get your picture taken? It was, I'd say, a great
moment. They were
moment.
So excited. They were. Too. It was great.
I thought they'd be, some kind of boat. Yeah. But I mean, these kids were really impressed by it.
That's awesome. Yeah. And I was joking with you, did you put them in the right formation?
Those smiles in that photo were like the most unauthentic thing.
No, you gotta have 100%
they wouldn't accurate. Be smiling. It's not historically accurate.
No life belts on.
Yeah.
No gas masks.
I was like, go drop them in the lake and see what happens.
I have to say, the veterans who came with their families had such a great time. Like I said, most of them stayed for the full week. We ended the week with our 1940s field chapel service, and they just really had a wonderful time. Mr. Belay was one of our D-Day veterans who was with us, for example. He and his wife flew up from Florida, stayed the whole week. They were at everything.
100 years old.
And
at the chapel service, I stood with him and with Ada Kuhn, 104-year-old.
104 and a half. Because 104 and a half, we cannot forget the half. Yeah.
But a veteran of the Women's Army Corps. And it just, it gave me pause. And there's more than 2 centuries of history right here beside me.
That was incredible. Yeah. And Ada was at everything, too.
Yeah.
I mean, she,
And by Sunday morning, we're like, whoo.
We were exhausted. Like, they were still ready to go. They're like, what's next? Are you stopping?
I'm like, I better go drink some more coffee.
They're ready to go now, probably, right? Yeah.
They are here for it.
Yeah. They're our heroes for sure. Amazing.
So real quick, before we get into We Salute You, was there anything you felt didn't go the way you wanted that you would do differently next time?
Oh,
anything?
For the projection, when we went in, there were a little bit of traffic problems, maybe because there were many tickets.
I think we were taken by surprise at the popularity of that. So I think we probably would plan a little for more people. Honestly, we just did not think that many people would still be with us and wanting to attend. So that would probably be the one thing that we would say, wow, there's a lot more people who want to attend than we realized.
Well, and that's really a trial or error thing because, we mentioned we've got plenty of space for people, not necessarily cars. And that was the issue there. And we weren't thinking like, oh, we need to run shuttle buses Friday and Saturday night because we've never done this before. Mm-hmm. Typically we have a concert or something else. Right. It's not nearly an issue. But I remember early on Friday when they're saying, I said, well, we need to just shut down.
The tickets sales kept going up. We kept looking.
Yeah,
and we're like, oh my gosh, we're at 1,500. we don't have that much parking, so we better stop. So yeah, that was a nice surprise. I mean, honestly, of anything that you could want to change, it's like, well, that's a good problem.
And I will say, what I ended up doing both nights was shuttling people on golf carts to their
The whole team was jumping in, helping.
If there were a few grumbles at the beginning, I didn't hear any of that at the end.
No,
I heard rave reviews about what they had seen. If they had to park 150 yards away, they considered it well worth it by the time it was over.
Yeah, and by Saturday we had kind of figured out.
Yes, we figured out a little better. Someone parked poorly and blocked a lot of parking spaces was one of the problems. So we eliminated that and things work better Saturday night and we'll work better when we get to do it again.
Oh, and that's right. And I think this is what I left with and you all probably concur with this too, is that, one of the questions I always get is, when all the veterans are gone, don't you worry about people's interest in D-Day and people coming? And I'd say that that's a resounding no, because from what we've seen, it's growing with school groups, with visitation. We've had some of the strongest visitation we've had in many, many years, even the 75th. I was just really amazed at the people who traveled from all over the country and all over the world to take part in this ceremony, to be with us. And I just really made my heart smile, because I know all of our veterans, those who've gone on, would be absolutely ecstatic at the interest and the level of people who want to learn and want to explore and want to know more. It's really great.
I've seen the same thing.
Yeah.
It's only growing.
Yeah.
And I think that pattern will continue.
I do too,
because in a way, because there are no more veterans anymore, and they want to try and get a connection to it in a different way. And
I would say, when people say that to me, I point out people still go to Gettysburg.
Yeah.
People still go to Yorktown.
That's right.
There will still be an interest in World War II, well into the future.
That's right.
And I think as long as we continue to look for the innovation in storytelling, whether that's the AR experience on the app, whether that's something like the projection show, whatever, what's the next thing that's coming down the pipeline? So now that we know who to call and ask, hey, what are you doing today that you weren't doing 5 years ago? We talk about our team, but we've been incredibly blessed to find the right people to ask
a lot of talented people.
Yeah. So
not to mention our volunteers, our supporters, our donors, our corporate sponsors,
and our very own Woody Watts here. Is that
Woody is the ultimate?
Played a big role also in the live
stream
podcast. Yeah. And I'll point out also, if you weren't able to be with us, it is still online. So go to our webpage and you can watch the whole June 6th ceremony and see what a really great success it was.
Yeah, we've got, of course, the 80th website will keep up for a while, but dday.org/80th, there's a button right there that takes you to the live stream. But also, if you're on our main webpage, we have a digital library where every live stream, every lecture, everything kind of lives. So you can see it there as well.
Yeah.
Sweet. Yeah. This has been fascinating. And I understand we have a very special We Salute You today.
Yes.
Hi, John.
Today on our We Salute You, we honor the service of Captain Walter Schilling of the famed 116th Regiment, a man who did not live to even touch Omaha Beach on D-Day, but who made a profound difference in the success of the invasion nonetheless. Walter Otis Schilling was born in Roanoke, Virginia in 1908, the son of a foreman for the city street department and the youngest of seven children. Little is recorded of his early life, but we know that in 1929, he joined the Virginia National Guard. He excelled at military service, and by 1935, he was commissioned as an officer in the 116th Regiment. In 1931, he became something else, a husband, when he married Marie Mason. 2 years later, the couple welcomed their only child, a daughter named Barbara. Few guardsmen in the pre-war years considered going to war a likely part of their story. But in February 1941, President Roosevelt called up the Virginia National Guard into the regular army for a one-year hitch. That December, of course, the men of the 116th suddenly heard of a place called Pearl Harbor, and they soon realized that they were at war and in the army until the end. Part of the Army's 29th Division, Walter Schilling, now a captain in command of Company D, 116th Infantry, shipped off to England to train his men for the coming cross-channel invasion. One baby-faced sergeant under Schilling's command was Bob Slaughter, later to become the founder of the National D-Day Memorial. Years later, Slaughter recalled his captain and the impact he had on the company. Quote, Schilling demanded unyielding compliance to all military rules and regulations, and he threw in a few of his own for good measure. Under his command, the military book of rules had to be read and learned. Punishment was meted out to the slow learners and reward to the willing achievers. He was a tough taskmaster, but I am sure he was teaching us the importance of following orders. End quote. Despite his gruff exterior and the fear he instilled in his men, Schilling was also a compassionate family man who cared deeply for his men and for their families back home. For instance, at Christmas 1943, he mailed a card to the parents of each man in his command. He also wrote frequently to his own wife and daughter. On June 1st, 1944, he sent a V-mail to his daughter Barbara in Virginia, age 10. Walter knew the Great Invasion was only days away, but of course he could not say this. He also knew the risk that faced him, and we might wonder if perhaps he had premonitions of his fate. He told Barbara days before D-Day, quote, "As your father, I have something I should say to you. I love you dearly, and you are very precious to me. Now, if something should happen to Daddy, never forget the great love he had for you. Always love and stick by your mother. Always look after her for me. Honey, some of this you won't understand now, but in the years to come, you will. Always be a good girl, and keep your mother's chin up. 600 million kisses, your daddy." On D-Day, Schilling's LCVP approached Omaha Beach not long after dawn. Schilling was in the front by the ramp, helping to guide the boat in. Before the ramp could drop, a German artillery shell hit the craft, blowing the ramp inward, killing the captain and wounding several men. The survivors made it to shore, but their valiant captain never set foot in France. But that is not to say he did not contribute to victory on D-Day. His contributions took place for almost 2 years before the invasion, as he shaped a ragtag bunch of civilians into a mighty fighting force, which would help take Omaha Beach, help to win St. Lo, and help to liberate France and defeat Nazi Germany. Walter Schilling lived to see none of that, but he deserves great credit for the valor, fidelity, and sacrifice of the men of Company D, 116th Regiment, 29th Division. We'll give the last word to Bob Slaughter, who knew Captain Schilling so well. Quote, "I myself was far from Schilling's favorite non-com. Not yet fully matured into manhood, I was one of the baby-faced juveniles who were always getting caught playing stupid pranks. I gradually grew up, but it took a while. Captain Schilling never knew how I felt about him, but there was no love lost between us, but I had great respect for him. I would have followed him to hell and back. Captain Walter Schilling, we salute you. Thank you for your service, and thank you for doing your part to save the world."
Okay, I need a couple of Kleenex for that one for sure. That letter.
And it's June 1st.
June 1st.
And I, you know, it's hard to just reading a little V-mail card, you know, to reconstruct the frame of mind. But I wonder if he was not thinking, mm-hmm, I might not come back from this.
Yeah.
Well, you'd have to be thinking that. Yeah. Yeah, I think so. And and his daughter having that the rest of her life. What a thing to have. I wonder how much she reflected on that throughout her life.
Yeah, Barbara lived until, I think, 2013 or so. And I would have loved to have talked to her. I don't know if you ever got to meet her, April, but it's just one of these stories that lives on.
Well, and I wonder from your guys' perspective, you see Bob Slaughter in a different light in a way, because, of course, to us, he's the elder statesman, right? We see him as this puerile teenager or whatever, right?
Anyway, he was 19. One of our favorite artifacts, which you've seen, John, I know, is Bob Slaughter's order of the day that he had all his buddies in Company D sign. And I noticed early on one name was missing, and that was Walter Schilling. I think Bob was probably intimidated by his captain to ask for his autograph. Yes. But in the end, what's his epitaph for his captain? He said, "I will follow him to hell and back."
Yeah, yeah. Such respect. That's leadership. Yeah, yeah.
I mean, that's leadership.
Yeah.
Right there in a nutshell.
Yeah.
All the issues they had, you know, I mean, we weren't there, but we get a sense of what this was, what the vibe was. And yet, when it came down to it, he was going to follow him through thick and thin. And he did, as long as Schilling was there.
But he's probably understanding he's tough on me for a reason.
That's right.
Yeah.
But it's not just. Yeah. Yeah.
Which is by nature of it hard to understand at the time. But, but over time, you really begin to appreciate that. And I suspect that Bob Slaughter maybe began to understand it as combat unfolded, too,
yeah,
I guess.
Exactly. Right? Yeah.
Gosh.
Yeah. Great story.
Wow. Well, thanks for sharing your perspectives on the crazy 80th anniversary. Yeah. It just.
Yours, too. Like
it was amazing. Yeah. Yeah. I'm glad I did it. It was a really great experience. Well, fortunate.
I'll start planning for the 81st now.
Yep, that's how it works. Makes you tired just thinking about it. I'm sure. again, thanks to everybody for sharing your perspective. Thanks for joining us. If you want to interact with us, which we greatly enjoy, please email our team at podcast@dday.org. Again, that's podcast@dday.org. If you're enjoying our discussions on World War II and its lasting impact, please subscribe to this podcast, share it with your friends. Rate it, leave us a review. We love to hear from you. Help us share the lessons and legacies of World War II. Thanks for joining us, everybody. Take care.
Someone Talked is a production of the National D-Day Memorial Foundation in partnership with Watts Creative Studios. Views expressed are not necessarily those of the foundation. This program was supported by a grant from Virginia Humanities. Virginia Humanities connects people and ideas to explore the human experience and inspire cultural engagement. As the State Humanities Council, Virginia Humanities reaches millions in its estimated annual audience through festivals, grants, fellowships, digital initiatives, teacher institutes, radio programs, podcasts, apprenticeships, and school programs. Headquartered at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, Virginia Humanities works to serve Virginians in every corner of the Commonwealth. To learn more, visit virginiahumanities.org. Located in Bedford, Virginia, the community that suffered the highest known D-Day loss per capita in the United States, Congress warranted the establishment of the nation's monument to D-Day in this emblematic American homefront. Receiving no federal or state funding, the memorial is operated and maintained by a private foundation and donor support. Explore the National D-Day Memorial, plan your visit, and learn more about upcoming events at dday.org. Join the conversation. Email our team at podcast@dday.org. It's no military secret that I love you.
Hey, how about romancing?
If you can keep a secret,
well, can I take you dancing?
If you'll take my heart and keep it, I'm not saying a word. I'm careful whatever I do.
I guess everyone's heard. I wanna give all my love to you.
If you gotta talk to someone, don't give any information. It's smart to be a dumb one. Simply change the conversation.
Let's talk about love.
That's what I'm thinking of.
It's no secret, no secret. It's no secret that I love you.